Happy Easter.
Hello and welcome to this, a special Easter edition of Desert Island Movies, and I am joined today by none other than Jesus himself. Well, it's obviously not actually Jesus, it's Ted Neeley, who played Jesus in the 1973 musical version of Andrew Lloyd Webber's Jesus Christ Superstar. So, hello, welcome, and thank you for coming to my island, Ted. How are you doing?
I'm telling you, thanks to you, today is magnificent. I'm happy you were interested enough for us to talk. So lay it on, man. I'm ready.
Brilliant. So I've previously, before we started the show, I've quickly gone through the rules with you. For those who aren't aware, who should be, because there's been a few shows by now, so you should have watched them, is that we have you on the desert islands. You are stranded here and you have to choose three films which you would want to be stranded with and one movie soundtrack, which we will get into shortly. The only rules being that you can't pick an entire series of films, so you can't pick the whole Harry Potter franchise, and you can't pick three sequels, so you can't go Godfather's one part two part three. That's cheating. So we'll get straight into it, Ted. So what would be your first film that you would have with you on the island?
I must tell you, it's a film that I have had with me all my life since I was a child, and you're not going to believe it. Pinocchio.
One and only Pinocchio.
Telling you, it's not about Pinocchio. It's about, as a child, I discovered Jiminy Cricket.
I'll bet a lot of you folks don't believe that.
I saw Pinocchio doing all this crazy stuff, and here was this little guy that was trying to help him. And I thought, oh, that's the kind of person I want to be. I want to help people achieve things, you know, and he's with me. He's right here on my collar. He's always beside me to keep me okay.
So it's a bit like your St. Christopher almost.
Absolutely right. I mean, if I feel strange, I'll put it on and watch it just because I can see Jiminy do all of his things. You know, it's just absolutely incredible.
That's amazing. So is there, obviously it's going to be a scene with Jiminy Cricket, but what are your particular favorite moments in Pinocchio?
No, I couldn't just pick any particular one because there's so many. Anytime he's on the screen with Pinocchio, I just get so excited still. To see that little guy, you know, Walt Disney's guys that did the animation were so brilliant making those. They were real people, but they were little animation things, you know, absolutely wonderful. So, you know, when he go, when you wish upon a star, there go. Ah! I'd look out the window every night as I was going to sleep, looking at the stars and the moon and hearing him. It makes no difference where you are. My skin is standing up right now.
You've got children, haven't you?
Yes, we have a daughter and a son. Yes.
So were they brought up on Pinocchio as well? Did you have sit?
No, I didn't. No. I didn't push anything on them, but they've certainly seen it. You know, they love it, but they're not foolish like their daddy, you know.
Oh, look, Father. Well, it's about time.
Talked about Pinocchio, but let's talk about something with you in which obviously you were in Jesus Christ Superstar, but at the time they made a documentary, or you made a documentary, should I say, you were one of the producers, called Superstars, which you've recently re-released, I believe, with extended footage in it.
Yeah, right. Tell us about bottom it. Line is this, because it has to do obviously with Superstar. We became such an instant, magnificent family of people. The eight principals, the whole company, Norman Jewison, brilliant, visionary, wonderful director, producer. So the time we were in Israel changed everybody's lives, especially mine. Not only what we were doing in the film with doing Norman's visuals of Tim Rice's lyrics and Andrew's music, but also I met the lady who became my wife. She's a dancer in the film. She grew up in the National Ballet of Canada. She's a brilliant ballerina. And if you've seen Superstar lately enough to recognize the Simon Zealot song, you know, Christ, you know, I love you. Did you? Okay. She's the lady in that that does all these really high extreme kicks, and they do a freeze frame on one of hers at one point.
I believe in you and God, so tell me that's it.
She's in every scene where there's dancing. She's face to face with King Herod, all, you know. So we met, and we're still together. She's still putting up with me after all this time. They haven't kicked me out of the house yet. There's still a possibility, but I'm still.
Well, you can't be kicked out during a pandemic, but.
So the whole thing is that everything about Superstar created such beautiful memories for all of us. And we get together as often as we can. So we did this video, this documentary. Actually, we made it about 5 years ago, just to, for us to have something to look at. And because it was shots of us doing interviews everywhere we've gone together to do things, where we've done those signing conventions and all that, plus things that happened in Israel. And the general idea was, it's our story thanking Norman Jewison, and it's all about behind the scenes. We're not showing you things from the movie. It shows you what we were doing while we were having a brilliant time in that experience. See, so we, Frank and I, decided to take it, re-edit it, put in these extra sequences showing each individual of the, we call them the Grateful Eight, the eight central characters who are now family, have always been, and then we have a magnificent photographer who was on set with us the whole time we were near, David James. And I asked him, did he have any photographs that were unseen? He's got volumes of photographs that were unseen, because he and his guys were taking pictures all the time, you see. So we have photographs in it that no one has ever seen before. I've never seen most of them even. So there's new things about each individual character and all of us together. And when we first did Superstar, when we first screened it, when we finished it, looking at it, all of us felt that we were a family in Israel on a vacation, and some guy was following us with a movie camera. It was that kind of a wonderful experience, a loving, wonderful experience. So that's why we decided to do the documentary. And hey, we're getting some great response. I can't believe it. I'm so happy that people appreciate it.
Yeah, no, I watched it this afternoon, obviously, in preparation for speaking.
So you
can really see, I mean, it's a real love letter to Norman Jewison.
Yeah, absolutely.
Times. It's because it's not, like you said, it's not just, here's us doing this bit in the film and here's this. It's an actual, this is what happened, this is what was going on, and this is the effect it had on the world after it came out. And there's some great stories in there.
Yes, and all of those interviews with Norman, you know, they had journalists on set all the time from different countries around the world interviewing us individually. So that's why we have that. And Norman basically tells why he decided to make a film, because he loved the album and he did blah, 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 blah. To hear him talk like that about it, people need to know that. He is a genuine, absolutely visual king.
Yeah.
Because he created the screenplay just from the songs.
It's really good. I thoroughly recommend everybody watching it. You can watch it online. It's being released in the UK in May, I believe. Is it May? May? Yes, May.
We just found out this morning. Sorry, but it's Vimeo. It's on Vimeo. Okay. Well, when we made the deal, they said, "Well, we only do America and Canada because we wanted worldwide." But we said, "Well, we want to get up for Easter, so let's do it." Okay, this morning. We find out that they've decided to go worldwide with this documentary, because it started streaming two nights ago, and the response that Vimeo got, they said, let's go worldwide. So you can even watch it on TV if you want.
Exactly. On your smart TVs, yes. I think this just shows the continuing power of, especially at this time of year, obviously it's Easter, but the continuing power of Jesus Christ Superstar, because I think people of faith, the story transcends with the music, and I think it just makes it more real. The film in particular, being filmed in Israel, I know it's very stylized, but it just feels real.
Think about that. It could have been shot in any desert anywhere, maybe on your desert island even, But,
there it is.
But the thing about it was Norman wanted to make it as authentic as possible. So he takes the entire company to Israel. He went to Israel and searched locations forever before we went there so he could get the authenticity that he wanted for each sequence. Everything you see in the film was historically there. We did nothing except they built the moat for King Herod's song and they placed that on the Dead Sea. And then when they were getting us to go to the Garden of Gethsemane, found it beautiful trees, but no grass, just sand and rocks. So he sent some of the crew ahead of time to plant the grass. So when we got there, we had a beautiful green carpet under those magnificent trees. So everything else was real. Even though like the scaffolding that was in King Herod the Great's castle, the ruins of it, they were going to take it down for it. That something had happened. One of the walls had collapsed. So they were repairing it. And they said, Mr. Jewison, we can take it down if you want. He said, no, I got an idea what I can do with that. And the priest climb all over that sucker. Anyway,
Because they still use that kind of stylization. The recent Jesus Christ Superstar Live that had John Legend in it. Yes. They have the scaffolding on as part of the set. So it's still considered part of the staging for the entire thing.
Yes.
It's incredible. It's incredible. Yes. Anyway, so what would be your second film that you would be happy with?
You're not going to believe this one, but Superstar. Jesus Christ Superstar. And the reason it's not about, you know, it's watching my family. What became my family. Mm-hmm. And we honestly, the whole time, no matter where we were walking anywhere, Matt, we were walking in somebody's amazing footsteps, you see?
Yeah.
And then we felt that we were right where what we were doing, right where it happened. We don't know where it happened, but even so, just being there, being in the Negev desert, being in the Dead Sea, being able to go to all of those ruins that were right there standing. We didn't do anything to them. That made such a difference for us, you see? So for that whole time we were there, it was just a miracle, absolute miracle for us. And that's why I would want to have that with me if I were on a desert island to cheer me up watching my family having such a wonderful time.
And you can sing along. You still find yourself singing along when it's on.
Yeah, I can't help it. Any of them, because we do screenings all the time. And up until the pandemic happened, we were doing sing-along screenings and everybody in the audience is singing and dancing. And it just, what a celebration. Well, we're going to do it as soon as it's lifted, the pandemic is gone, but we won't be able to sing because, you know, everybody's singing, you know, who's carrying whatever. So, but we'll still do the screenings. And it's changed my life in every possible way. And think about it. We did the Broadway show in 1971. We shot the film in 1972. It came out in 73. And I've been doing it off and on ever since. and soon the 48th anniversary happens.
Yeah.
The 50th anniversary since we'd opened the Broadway show is now, you see?
Wow.
So think about that. 50 years later, I'm still singing those songs.
Talking about it.
Yes. And here's the big miracle. I'm only 33. Okay?
Yeah, absolutely. That's brilliant. That's excellent. Will you be bringing it to the UK, more importantly?
I sure hope so.
Yeah, so are there any particular, I mean, you're going to say all of it, but are there any particular songs or any particular scenes, not even necessarily your ones, that you really love in that film?
Superstar?
Yeah.
One that I am literally most moved by is Barry singing Pilot's Dream.
Then I saw thousands of millions crying for this man. And then I heard them mentioning my name and leaving me the blame.
Mm. Yeah.
The way he did that and the trial by Pilate, you know, where they beat me up after and whip me and all that. But when he's going, don't let me stop, the passion that he threw into that. And when he's holding me, where are you from, Jesus? What do you? I didn't cry. I always cried. Just, and even today, when I get a chance to do it live, I never have done the show without crying. and really? Especially in Gethsemane. Mm. And it's difficult to cry and sing at the same time.
Yeah, especially with that big note. the big note, yeah, that most people are afraid of. But,
and I also love Could We Start Again, Please, where everybody has realized that maybe what Jesus is doing was good, so let's get together and see what we can work out, you know. Mm-hmm. And every time Carl Anderson opens his mouth, Jesus, you started to believe. And like I said, I auditioned for Judas. That's the role I wanted to play, you see. but Carl and I were dear buddies, and we had that relationship. Norman said, boom, you're here. Yeah. Just everything about and the see Caiaphas and Annas, you know, oh gentlemen, what can I do about Jesus? Okay,
I think I could possibly pull off Caiaphas these days. I used to be able to do Gethsemane, but not anymore. So, what would be your third film then that we would be looking at?
All right, ready?
Yeah,
Hard Day's Night.
Oh, wow. Oh, wow. The Beatles.
Yes. Such a big Beatles fan, you know, from the first day, and mainly because of my band, we left high school and went out for the summer to California, and everything went great for us in Hollywood. And we were playing all of these private clubs in Beverly Hills and Beverly Hills backyard parties and nightclubs on, you know, Sunset Strip and Whiskey A Go-Go, all that. And everything was going so great. So these backyard parties became quite interesting. And it was always actors inviting actors to their home for a great celebration, and their backyards were the size of a football field with swimming pools and all that sort of thing. And we'd be built up on those platforms so they could see us above what they were doing. Well, one of these, we were just rocking out in Beverly Hills. We were having the best time. You remember the actor Tony Franciosa? Anthony Francis. Okay, well, we were playing in his home, his backyard home, and it was the most packed one we had done to that point. And there was this magnificent oak tree, gigantic tree that was just over to the left of our stage, but you know, a good 30 feet away from us. And there was this man who was standing, leaning up against the tree comfortably, having a drink and watching us, just staring at everything we were doing. And every so often, somebody would come up and refill his drink, and he'd lean back against the tree. And what turned out, that man was the president of Capitol Records.
Wow.
And 2 weeks later, he signed us to the label because of what he saw what we were doing. Completely unknown band, except as what we did, he thought was worthy of being recorded. And we go in a studio there in Hollywood and record the album, and it's set for release. And guess what album came out the same, not only the same week, but the same day on Capitol Records as ours.
It wouldn't be Jesus Christ Superstar, would it?
The Beatles.
Oh, the Beatles.
So can you guess who sold the most records?
Well, I would assume the Beatles, but I'm probably wrong.
I don't think we sold even two, you know. But I was such a fan of their work and the creative of those songs that they wrote. And then when Hard Day's Night came out, wow. I went nuts, and I loved the film, and not only the music in it, but the film, because like in the beginning where all the girls are chasing all the guys, you know, and they're doing all of their stuff. And then the grandfather comes on the scene, the character Paul's grandfather, and he's chasing girls now, trying to figure out how to do his thing and hang out with the boys. I loved everything about it. Everything. Yeah,
so have you watched it recently, or has it been a while?
I haven't. No, I haven't, but I will. Now that we've discussed it,
we've talked about it, you're going to watch it again, yeah.
Yes. When I get home to you, I find the things that you do will
make me feel all right. So going back to the documentary, Superstars, which is available on Vimeo, everybody. So can you tell us about some of it? Because it's an extended version now. What has been added in for the extended version?
Well, I can give you an example because, in all these years since we actually did the film, not to mention just the interviews that happened with the media while we were on the set, between scenes, they would come up and talk to Norman or to me or to Barry or to Bob or whomever. We also started doing screenings. And we ever so often we would get all of us together. Anytime we were in any area near where anybody lived, because everybody was working. Yvonne lives in Hawaii, you know, so it's a little hard for her to go to New York for one screening or whatever. So, yeah. But we did that as well. And we were also constantly invited to these autograph festivals where they bring all kinds of people in. And there were always media there for that. And it's us acting like little kids at these signings. It just, we had so much fun with everybody. In fact, there was one we did in New Jersey a long time ago. And we were getting ourselves together before they opened it for the crowds to come in. And we're in this one big room. It's just the superstar room alone, just us. We're doing our thing, you know. And all of a sudden, in walks one of the tokens.
Oh.
And when we saw him walk in, all of us were going, and that's in the video because it's yeah. Look, here we are, all those actors being goofy and having a great time. You see Josh Mostel doing the impersonation of himself. It's it's a character. It's incredible. Larry Marshall, there was one time with Larry Marshall who was Simon. He was on the opening area of the room, so he would be the first guy they would see. You know, and he told us, we didn't know because each one of us had our own table and all that. But after that first day, he said the first person that walked up to his table, he was looking at all the photographs and everything. And Larry's sitting right there. And he said, excuse me, is Larry Marshall going to be here today? He didn't recognize him at all. Anyway, everything that has happened for us has been wonderful. That sequence is wonderful with Larry. The sequence with Barry Dinnan.
Yeah.
Well, bless his heart, you know, he passed not that long ago.
Yeah.
So we built that into a tribute for Barry. Yeah. That segment is him talking. He cries in the middle of it, answering questions and all that. Yeah. But there is a song that's underscored in that, a passionate, beautiful ballad that Barry actually wrote.
Oh, okay.
For a screenplay, I mean, that he was putting together to do, and it's one of the soundtrack songs, and it's his song, and it's called A Song With No Name.
Mm.
And it's sung by one of our buddies from Hair many, many years ago. He came in it because he sounded like the lead singer. He sounded like Dennis Tufano.
Right.
Okay. Anyway, so great voice. And there are moments throughout the whole thing that just make me tear up, especially the moments with Norman Jewison's interviews.
Yeah,
because they're on the set between scenes and he's talking about why he chose this person and that person and how he put it together. And he does this whole thing about Carl Anderson because so many people challenged him because he, forgive me, casted a person of color to play the role of Judas.
Yeah.
And nobody knows that that's the role I wanted to play. You see, you could not find anybody who could even get near Carl Anderson's interpretation of that. And he and I had done the show many times together before the film. So the relationship was there. So I could pull out each segment all the way through the whole 90-minute documentary. But the point I'm trying to make is I'm so emotional about certain elements.
Yeah,
seeing Bob Bingham sitting there and talk about the influence that Norman had on him, Kurt Yajin, everybody. And Yvonne, bless her heart, she tells you how Norman was helping her make sure she looked sort of like sexy, you know. And she said, right. So all of those, that just made my hair stand up, just thinking about what we really experienced during the shooting of the film. But it's not scenes from the film. It's behind the scenes as we had the experience.
No, it's brilliant. So yeah, so there are some really great, the bit where you're in the actual screening, the cinema screening, and you're all on the chairs at the front, and then Norman gets up from the front, you know, you just see it on all your faces. And
well, that one you just referred to was the only full anniversary celebration that we've had together, you see.
Right.
Because everybody was always off doing other projects except for Carl. Unfortunately, he had passed before we got to do that one. So we always canonize Carl every time we do anything because without Carl.
That's a nice touch, though. It's a nice touch. Mm. No, absolutely. So now we've done your films, you're going to need some music to listen to. What are you going to be taking with you to listen to?
Well, certainly Hard Day's Night fills that category as well, you know, with the songs. Mm. But I also love the film Tommy.
Yeah.
the songs in that song, because I played Tommy as well. Yeah. But they have those songs sung the way they were sung in the film, the cast of the film of Tommy. Everything is celebratory. Tina Turner, my God, the Acid Queen. Tina Turner. So those things are what bring me up, no matter how down I might be. And thank goodness I'm seldom down anyway. But if I were stranded on the desert island alone, I would want to have that to cheer me up.
Yeah, so it's a great, another great musical. So, fantastic choice. So you do a cameo channel, don't you? This is quite popular with a lot of celebrities across the board. So I know we're talking about the documentary, but I'd like to mention Cameo because I think it'd be good, because people can get in touch with you via Cameo, can't they? You can do messages for them and greetings and all that kind of stuff, can't you?
And so, I can't tell you how much I love doing those. They're all so positive, and I get a chance to talk with them. The only downside is they're only 3 minutes long. In 3 minutes I sneeze. One sneeze takes me 3 minutes. But to be able to have people from all over saying, "Oh, my aunt, or my sister, my brother, my uncle, my whole family, blah blah blah. Can you just say Merry Christmas or Happy Birthday or whatever?" It's so sweet, and I feel so good to be able to lift spirits. It's just, I'm blessed once again and honored to be part of Cameo.
That's amazing. So what I would do is below here for people watching, I will put all the links so they can
contact
you for Cameo. They'll be able to watch the documentary. I'll put the Vimeo link in there and all that kind of stuff.
Thank you.
I'll probably even link in Jesus Christ Superstar on iTunes or something, because everybody should be watching. It's actually in the UK, I don't know about globally, but it's actually available via Prime Video over here. So if you've got Prime, you can watch it on Prime Video at the moment. Yes. And I only know that because I watched it before I came on. So
the film.
Well,
Easter, certainly it's available, I'm pretty sure, around the world, Easter and Christmas,
And it's normally on a TV channel somewhere.
And there are a couple of nice songs in there.
Oh, it's cracking. It's cracking. It's one of my favorite musicals. So, I'm kind of biased. But anyway, so thank you very much, Ted, for coming to the island.
My pleasure. I hope that I can come over and spend some time there on the island, and we can mix our songs together.
We can do a Jesus Christ Superstar sing along. We'll be doing the singing, and I'll just be following along. Yeah. So once again, thank you. It's been an absolute pleasure. Everybody, please subscribe to the channel. Please follow. I'll also put all of your social media links so people can follow you on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram.
Thank you.
Everywhere else.
Thank you.
That's no problem, Ted. Thank you for coming on. You look after yourself now. And everybody, we will see you soon.